I want to call the RWRA Rate Review Board meeting to order for March 2nd, 2017. Please stand. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the gifts that we receive from you. We ask that you watch over the men and women who serve in our armed forces as well as all of our emergency responders. I ask for wisdom and understanding for this court and this Rate Review Board. Grant us humility in our everyday life and give us the courage to make right decisions for our Davis County and Owensboro community. We ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Once again, I want to welcome everyone to this joint board that reviews the rates proposed by RWRA. Mayor and sir. City commissioners, welcome to Davis County Fiscal Court.
Thank you, sir.
Kelly, would you call the roll, please, and establish a quorum?
Okay. Judge Mattingly?
Here.
Commissioner Castlin?
Present.
Commissioner Wathen?
Here.
Commissioner Koger?
Here.
Mayor Watson?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Glenn?
Here.
Commissioner Smith Wright?
Here.
Commissioner Velotta?
Here.
Commissioner Condor?
Here.
We have a quorum.
Okay, thank you, Kelly. Commissioners, for your information, if you look at the bottom of the mics,
push it, push the button,
and it will come on. You'll see a little green light. Do you see her there? Did it come on, Commissioner? Okay. I'm sorry we don't have mics for everyone, but we can share. The next item on the agenda is consider for approval the minutes of the December 6, 2016 meeting.
Second.
I have a motion, second. Mayor and commissioners, hopefully you've had the minutes in your possession and had enough time to review them. Are there any additions, deletions, or corrections? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next item is a presentation, the rate presentation by Plant Moran and RWRA staff and discussion of related resolution. We have Joe Shepherds, the director of RWRA. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you, sir. And thanks for having us here today. I appreciate you coming out. Real quick, I'll do brief introductions. We got two board members here. We got Ed Cecil and John Stevenson. We've got our board attorney, Charlie Kamoff, here. Staff, we have Kelly Pfeiffer over here. We've got Dean Binky and Sean O'Brien, Lacey Cunningham, and Victor Cernius. Today, I'd like to introduce Blake Rowe. Blake Rowe is a CPA and a partner with Plant Moran. Plant Moran's a large nationwide firm that specializes in working with utility rates. Blake here does a lot with water and wastewater rates. So at this time, I'd like to introduce Blake Rowe and have him get started with the presentation.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about the financial model that was created and a little bit about financial modeling. So to help you understand how management was able to arrive at the recommendations they're going to present for you this afternoon. So first and foremost, you're aware that we did help the agency develop a forecasting model. It's very dynamic. It's comprehensive. It really is a living tool. It's the tool the agency is going to use on a go-forward basis to help take a look at their rates every time they go through a study to understand what they think they should do. So you're going to see this again and again. And really, it primarily focuses on ensuring that you have the appropriate level of working capital. And I want you to think about that as the dollars you have day to day that you need to pay your bills and keep things running. And also focuses on sustainable levels of reserves. When you hear reserves, I want you to think about capital projects and the infrastructure. Also, the other three really important components of the model are going to be making sure you're segregating your revenue requirements between what is operating and what is replacement needs, smoothing the long-term effect of any changes in rates on the users. You don't want to be following a wave pattern when you're introducing rate changes. You want to keep it as smooth as possible and have folks be able to anticipate what's going to happen as far in advance as possible. Then lastly, we really want to be able to have an understanding of what the effect of any changes have on those average customers and some of our bigger users. So the first thing to think about when you're modeling is what's your starting point. And a lot of times when we walk into client situations, it's a situation where the client has waited a little bit too long and they end up in a position where they're really operating, they're starting out in a weak position. The good news here is when we came through the doors here, that's not what we saw. We saw some financial statements in a position that was really reflected a lot of financial responsibility. You had adequate working capital currently, fiscally responsible reserves, and really a fairly practical rate for those users. So you don't have to start out by making up for lost ground. That's the really good news. Now you do have to be very intentional on a go-forward basis to help you get to where you want to go and to make sure you don't sidestep. So let's take a quick look at where we are currently. So what we've got in this chart right here is the working capital balances, let's call it that. I want you to think about working capital for each of your nine funds at the end of your last fiscal year. So when you take a look at the operating fund, you've got about a little less than 1 month's worth of cash sitting there that you would need to operate. When you go to the replacement fund, that column's a lot taller, and that really is a nice chunk of money, but you need to realize that a lot of that is already spoken for. There were projects that were deferred and projects that are planned, so that money's really going to be utilized. Then you have the environmental fund, and that's really where you're handling all your LTC plan is going to be out of there. And you can see there's a minimal reserve there. Then the next three or four sort of take care of themselves. We all kind of know what those are. We paid for some things in advance through assessments and then the development fund, and we'll get paid back over time, and everybody understands that. Then you get all the way down to that last one, that reserve fund. That's a pretty sizable balance. It's $6 million, and it's really policy that it maintain that level. And when management was making their decisions on how to go forward, they maintained that level on a go-forward basis. So the question is, that's where we're at. Where do we really want to go? How do we want to go, and how do we get there? So you can see those black lines that are above those first three funds. We really want to focus on those, because once again, those other funds, we understand the mechanisms that are driving those. The ones we can really affect over the next few years are those first three funds. And I want you to think about the operating fund and the replacement fund. I want you to think about those in tandem. Those really are related, because right now we got that split. As revenue comes through the door, there's this split that occurs that sends it in two different directions. And we can alter that and get it to the right place to help us stabilize those funds where we want them. So you can see right now you've got a little under 1 month's operating cash in the operating fund. That black line in the replacement fund, that represents 6 months of debt service. So if you maintained a balance there of about 6 months in debt service, that would probably be an appropriate place to be as we sat back and thought about the business decision between where those things should be. And very similarly for the environmental fund, that black line would represent 6 months worth of debt service, would put you in a nice safe position. So in order to get there and get those bars in the right places and hit those lines, we're going to have to make some intentional decisions. And the first step in doing that is really understanding what the drivers are that you have to consider to make those decisions. There's two primary drivers when you think about what your revenue requirements have to be. The first one are your cost drivers. And we bullet pointed 7 or 8 there of the primary drivers of cost. And what I want you to think about when you look at those, when you talk about, you know, utility costs, health insurance, retirement, there's a lot of costs in there that you don't have necessarily direct control over. You're relying on outside forces that are sort of setting what those costs are going to be. So you have to understand and realize that some of those drivers are going to go up in the future at a pace greater than inflation, and you may not have a lot of control over that. So we got to take that into consideration as we think forward. Second part of that page is that chart, and I call that the consumption drivers. It's a pretty easy equation, really, when you think about rates need to be. Here's our costs, and here's the consumption. Now let's figure out how to make those two work. The thing you need to really understand when it comes to rates is you don't necessarily have a lot of control over the consumption as well. We've got two bars on there, the red one and the blue one. The red one represents your residential users, and the blue one is your commercial users. Let's focus on that red one for a moment there. We've got the chart going from 2006 out to 2022. So you need to realize that the numbers starting in 2006 all the way to 2016, those are actual numbers. And you can kind of see that downward trend. And it's not that you have fewer users. You've got this ongoing trend, which is happening across the entire country, of residential users using less and less water on an annual basis. At some point in time, that's going to bottom out, maybe even shift up a little bit. Management made a decision in our assumptions that are driving the model that we don't want to pretend that we know when that trend for the last 30 years is all of a sudden going to turn around. And it'd be more conservative to continue along that trend as we go forward. So that's one of the things that's driving the model. It's always tempting once you have developed a model, the first thing you want to do is say, okay, what if we didn't do anything going forward? What's our do-nothing scenario? What would happen? So I want to show you that briefly. And once again, I want to take you back to those reserve levels so you understand what the effect would be. So we've already got a couple of increases that are already legislated and planned. So those are built into here. But what we did is we took each of those nine balances and we ran them out through 2022. So once again, that first group of bars is the operating fund. And you can see how quickly that starts to deteriorate. And then you see the replacement fund next to it, which kind of increases a little bit, then comes back down a little bit. Once again, we talked about that. I'd really like you to think about those two in tandem. And when you go all the way out to 2022, when you add those two together, that negative number and the positive number, you're still at about an $8 million deficit in working capital for those two funds. So obviously, that doesn't get us to where the black bars are. If I do another click here, I show you where those black bars are. So now the task is to take that living model and work with the assumptions, work with what you can control, and try to get it back up to those bars over the next few years and try and stabilize them. So I'll bring the director back up now, and he can talk through how management went about deciding on how to get those bars where you want them and their recommendation. Yes, sir.
Before you go, anyone have any questions about what's been presented? Mayor?
I got a couple of questions. On the first page of your rate analysis tool, how is the smooth effect of long-term rate changes? How have you been doing that?
Here's what you need to think about when you want to try and smooth those effects. The last thing you want to do.
I understand that, but what's occurred to make me believe that we've had smooth effect of long-term rate changes?
That would be the goal going forward.
Going forward. Okay, we haven't
going
done
forward.
That in the past then.
Going forward.
All right. On this one chart, it says you don't have any debt service fund. Can you explain that to me? Is this going forward? So tomorrow you're going to pay off all your debt, or the city of Orangeboro going to pay
off? Yeah, historically. So that's pretty much a wash fund. I mean, it goes in and out.
Income, expenditures equals revenue. So it's what comes in goes out.
Those monies come from the other funds that are up there. And as soon as they're in there, boom, they're out for the debt service. So there really should be no balance in there on a go forward.
Pass-through account.
Yeah, pass-through, that's a good way to say it.
Okay, who determines or how do you determine the practical level for the average homeowner? What is the average homeowner?
So by looking at your actual data, we can tell what the average consumer uses and everything's built. Some components of your rate are based off consumption you take into the fixed rates. So we can tell what the average user what the effect is on the average user, and I think that's 3,900 gallons a year, and that's really part of the director's presentation is to show you the effect on the average user as they go forward with their recommendation.
So do you do that same for commercial, same thing, for commercial users?
It's not average. Commercial is all across the board. I mean, you got some really large.
You need to be up there, Joe.
Okay, sorry. You got some, commercials all across the board. You got some large consumers and some small ones. They're all across the board. Our average residential is about 3,900 gallons a month right now.
So proportionally, both commercial and residential are carrying the same load then?
And not proportionally, no. We got a graph I can show you if you'd like to see it.
I mean, it's going to be later on?
We can, yes, sir.
Okay. So if you encourage us to use less water, we get punished by charging us more for water. Is that correct?
We try not to look at it that way.
Well, that's how I look at it. So,
You do have a closed system. You do have significant amount of fixed fees that have to be covered either way, no matter how much water is used.
Okay.
You do have a large portion of the system that would be what I would call closed. You've got to cover those costs.
Yeah. Mayor, I was going to ask Joe to explain. We, over the past, 4 or 5 years, RWRA has changed their model on how they charge their customers. And if you look at the cost drivers on the left are basically covered by a customer user fee. If you look at the cost driver on the other side, the consumption, that's based on the amount of usage by the customer. And really, I think 4 or 5 years ago, Joe, we looked at trying to address the issue that folks were saying, we're using less, but we're getting punished. In this model, you can see if you use less, you get charged less tier, but you've got to pay, folks have to pay just like you do with a gas meter charge or an OMU electric meter charge or a water meter charge. You have to have a base cost, a base charge that pays for the potential. You may be in Florida for 6 months and not use any water, so you don't pay any consumption over here, but you still have to pay for the maintenance of the system, so when you get back. So I think, and Austin, I don't want to beat you up, but I think that the press has driven in or keyed on, you know, we use less and we're getting charged more, but it's not necessarily true. You're actually, this is addressing that issue that you brought up, I think.
And we can show you some graphs here in a little bit, Mayor, if you'd like to see them. If you're okay with deferring that question toward the end, I got some graphs at the end that I can show you that answer some of that.
I'm just riding in the boat.
Okay.
Judge, if you don't mind, please.
Yes.
I have a question.
Yes, Commissioner.
Joey, if you won't mind, the work that you're going to be doing on the East Side Station, in conjunction with the growth that's happening on 54, does your rate model take into account all of the work that's going to be done there, or is that exclusive of your rate model?
Our rate model's taking into account projected growth in that area. Now, if you're talking about like work we're going to do, anything, any expansion out there in the next 5 years is anticipated in the model as additional revenue coming in and as additional expense to maintain it and to build it.
So again, it's a net-net, as you had described it earlier? That is, what's coming in, you're going to be able to pay for, correct?
Everything, well, that's part of what's in the model, yes. The revenues that's going to come in is, our model has both revenue and expenditure in it.
Mm-hmm.
Our anticipated growth is anticipating the revenue that's coming in from the East Side growth, and it's got the anticipated expenditure from the East Side growth. And it's a balanced model.
Yes, Commissioner.
Joe, when I look at the bullet points on the first page that you presented, it says segregate revenue requirements between operating and replacement needs. And it says this is a new rate analysis tool. My question is, has that been done in the past, or is what we're seeing a change? And prior to you all creating this, what we're looking at were those numbers pooled together?
They've always been separated. Operations and operations and replacement has always been separated. What we're doing
right,
as part
I
of
understand.
This model is looking at the percentage of separation between the two. So how much percentage goes to operating and how much goes to replacement. This is tweaking that percent and taking a little bit more into operations, a little bit less into replacement. But they've always been two separate funds coming from the same revenue. It's just, this is tweaking the percentage between the two.
Okay.
Yes.
So the next question I've got for you is, you've got a 5-year rate cycle, sorry, I know I'm on top of that, but you can change it after just two, you can go 2 years, you're locked in for 2 years, after that you can come back to us and adjust again. I know this is not a fair question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Given that you're doing Cedar Hills, you're taking over those package plants out there, you've got growth on 54, like Commissioner Connor said, do you think that the ratepayers can expect that we will be able to hold it for 4 or 5 years, or do you anticipate having to tweak this model and come back and adjust rates upward for years 3 through 5?
Our anticipation is that this will take us through the next 5 years, but that's all we put in here, recommendation. We'll come back before you in 2 to see, were we too conservative or too liberal in our assumptions? So we'll come back before you in 2 years to adjust the rates if need be, or to tell you it's looking great, this is what we want to keep. Yes, sir, that's our intent. And that's part of what you'll be voting on, is to actually require us to come back in 2 years.
So it could go down then.
yes, sir, and that's part of it. If we look
good
at
luck
it,
with
we
that.
See that it's too conservative of a model, the rates could come down. But that's part of the tool that they're giving us, is the tool is something we own now and something that we're going to keep using. Every year at our budget cycle, when we present to the board, we're going to go out the next 5 years.
while we're going to present a five-year plan to you every 2 years, we're going to present it to the board every year. So I'm going to have this model that we now own, that we can tweak, that I can keep our board up to date every 12 months when we do our budget. It's a lot stronger model.
Yeah, one of the things I wanted to mention, Commissioner Glenn, one of the things that was changed 5 years ago, 6 years ago, was the mandate that you come back every 2 years so that we can look at it to prevent what happened prior to that. What happened prior to that was they didn't have a rate, what, it was 10, 12 years with no rate increase, and guess what everyone on the rate board at that time had to do? We had a substantial rate increase. We also asked that they projected out at four, I think it was 4 years, maybe 5 years then, and I think it's just, it's good so that consumers and potential folks who are going to locate their businesses here can take a look and have some degree of certainty as to what the cost will be.
Yeah, and that's what's good about why we chose Plant Moran. You know, all of our previous rate studies, they give us a nice pretty three-ring binder. It's get put up on the shelf and other books get stuck on top of it. They're not giving us a three-ring binder. They're giving us a model that's a working model that we're going to keep using for every aspect of our budget. So that's why we chose Plant Moran.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
How are these rates compared to other cities our size?
Okay, I can get to that in a little bit, if you're okay with that. I can answer it now, or I can get to it in the presentation here in a little bit.
Any other questions before we leave? You're on.
Okay. Okay, real quick, you're now on slide 7 for if you're following on your paper there. I'll go through real quick where we're at today, the current rate structure. First three rates that you see up there, that's the current rates that all customers pay. We got the customer service charge is $12.95 a month. Like the judge said, that is the same no matter how much usage you do, you use. You go off to Florida for 3 months, you're still paying $12.95 a month. The second, the wastewater user charge is $4.39 per 1,000 gallons. That is depending on how much you use. Well, if you go to Florida for 3 months, that'll be zero. Those two combined is what we use for our day-to-day operations and replacement. So they're the two key that we use every day. The third one's environmental improvement fee. That does all of our environmental projects, like the long-term control plan that's now been approved by the Division of Water. That's a standalone fund that fee goes in. It's used for nothing but that. So right now, the current rates, the average customer is billed about $34.02 a month. The bottom four that you see is generally what we call new construction. The capacity fee is a fee that comes in that started in 97, which is where the theory in 97 was growth pays for growth. This is the one, if you go back in 97 and read the resolution when it first started, it uses the word of buy-in. Buy-in is a direct quote from it saying that what they want to do is have all new customers buy into the existing infrastructure so that they weren't coming in and using infrastructure that other people had paid for. So that's a $525 flat fee. It can be financed as a monthly fee for 20 months. So anybody comes in, pays a capacity fee if you hook on after 1997. The next two, system development and assessment, those are basically fees to go out into the county or go out off of our main system and start picking up other developments. Again, those two are growth pays for growth. Connection fee of $300 is basically to connect on, anybody connects on to our system. So the top three is everybody pays for. The bottom four is more for new construction. This is our non-residential. I'm not going to go through it in detail. The main difference between non-residential and residential is bullet points four and five. We get some volume surcharges and some quality surcharges depending on what industry sends our way. I can go into this, but basically it's about the same. Okay, now I'm going to get into the recommendations. Our first recommendation is on the environmental improvement fee. Again, I'm doing this first because it's kind of the simplest one. It is a standalone fee that is based on our long-term control plan. As you all are aware, this year We finally have got the long-term control plan approved by Division of Water and accepted by the EPA.
How long have you been working on that, Joe?
Oh, probably about 12 years, realistically 9 to 12 years. So in that plan that's finally approved, we have listed out 16 projects that you see here. The projects are listed, the project names are listed, and the schedule is listed. At the bottom, you see the engineer's estimate at about $30 million. We don't have a lot of control over this. This is something we're mandated to do. We don't have a lot of control on the schedule. So what we did is we took this approved plan, put it into our five-year capital plan, and then buried our five-year capital plan into our model. So in putting that into the model, we've determined that we have to increase our environmental fee in order to pay the debt service on these projects. We're not trying to fund these projects up front. We're assuming that we get some KIA or other form of loans. So this is to pay for the debt service on these projects. We calculate that we need an additional $1.20 per month increase to pay for these. And that increase is every year for the next 5 years. We're also on the non-residential, we're needing an increase of 7 cents per 1,000 gallons. So if you go down and take a look at, for example, on July 1st of 17, we're gonna go from $3.95 a month to $5.15, and our surcharge is gonna go from 28 cents to 35 cents. You go back and look, several years ago when RWRA first brought up the environmental improvement fee, what they had calculated at that time was we would need $6.95 per month. In lieu of giving $6.95 per month, based on the Rate Review Board's recommendation, RWRA went down to a lot less environmental improvement fee, which is now $3.95. So you see, the intent was to wait until we knew what the long-term control plan would be. We would have an exact model. We knew what we'd have to do. So we're still below what was recommended several years ago. But this is exact. We now know what we need. Okay, the next one is the wastewater user charge. That's our volume charge. The last Rate Review Board meeting, it was approved to go from $4.39 per thousand up to $4.60 per thousand. What we're saying now is we do not want to take advantage of that $4.60. We're going to keep it at $4.39 for the next 5 years and leave it at a flat rate. We feel that we can keep it at that rate and use the customer service charge.
So what that means is Keith Lawrence, who's sitting back there, if he saves some water usage, he gets to pay himself for it.
That is correct.
That's good news, isn't it, Keith?
A customer service charge. We're proposing two changes on the customer service charge. In the past, RWRA had always based the customer service charge on the meter size. We want to go back to basing it on the meter size. We feel there's more equity in that. The larger the meter, the more you're using. We want to go back to based on the meter size. There's also equity in competition out there. We have some apartment complexes that may have four meters. We have some apartment complexes that have maybe 100 meters. So this goes back to getting a little bit more equity in our system. What we're doing on this is the one inch meter, is what we're calling the base. Everything is based off of that. So anytime I refer to the base charge, I'm talking about what's being billed against a 1 inch meter. So you look at that, everything less than 1 inch meter is still being charged to a 1 inch. Everything larger than 1 inch, it goes up by the square of the meter. We're topping out at a 6 inch meter. So if you're a larger industry that comes in with larger than a 6 inch meter, we're still capping off at the 6 inch meter to keep that charge from getting completely out of hand. Yes, sir.
How does the customer know what size meter he's got?
I'm not sure.
How do they determine?
Most residential meters and OMUs, not here, but are 5/8 meters. That's the vast majority of the residential.
Okay, well. Yeah, to answer that, mm-hmm. About 97% are going to be 1 inch or less. And when you get into the residential, our entire network, there's only 10 residential units that have larger than a 1 inch meter. And all 10 of them are places that have like a really large shop in their backyard or things like that. So there's only 10 customers, there's only 10 residential customers in our entire network. It's got larger than one-inch meter. So when you get to the 1.5 and larger, it's all commercial that's using a lot more water. Okay, on this one, we're proposing taking the base and increasing it $1.10 per month every year for the next 5 years. So in the first year, what you see up there range from $14.05 to $505.80. Okay, capacity. And this one here is the one that we're proposing the most changes. If you recall earlier, we talked about capacity was based on the theory of growth pays for growth. And going back to the original resolution, talks about the buy-in. It wants to make sure that the new customers buy into the existing infrastructure. Going through our numbers, we feel that the buy-in's complete. We feel that the new growth has more than paid for their share of what of the infrastructure. So at this point, we want to go back to more of a homogeneous system. We want to go back to treating all of the rate payers the same, to where every rate payer is paying the same amount. So what we're proposing is on July 1st of 2017, we go away from charging the new customers the flat fee of $5.25 to charging all customers a 53-cent per month capacity fee. Again, we're treating this like customer service charge. The base fee is 53 cents. It will be based on your meter size. So like the customer service charge, it'll be based on the meter size. Unlike the customer service charge, this 53 cents is not going to be increased. So for the next 5 years anyway, we will not increase the capacity fee. It'll stay, the base will stay at 53 cents for 5 years. Yes, sir.
Proportionally speaking, is the growth inside the incorporated city limits or outside the incorporated city limits?
We have both. Okay, so I would have to go back. Maybe Lacey could look that up. I'd have to go back to actually look to see how much is inside and how much is outside. If you look at a lot of the developments inside the city, any development prior to 97 or after 97 pays a capacity. So you look at like the Heartlands, or you look at basically anything built after 97 is paying this. I don't have that answer off the top of my head. I'm not sure if it's something you can get.
So this, but this recommendation, does it even it out if it's unbalanced one way or the other? Is that what you're saying?
What it does is it's treating, it's similar to the, we're treating it similar to the environmental fee. Like right now, everybody in the system pays environmental fee. Capacity would be similar to environmental, where everybody in the system would be paying the same fee.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not sure I followed you when you said that the development or whatever that's occurred, all the new additions to the system, that we need to switch to this approach. I don't.
Okay, all.
I'm just not following you, if you try again.
Okay, right now, the people that pay the capacity fee is anybody that's hooked on to the system after July 1st of 97. Doesn't matter if you're city or county.
Right, but they pay it to the tune of the 525. Once that's paid off, they don't pay it anymore.
That is correct.
Okay, so this is going to be an ongoing. So how do you balance those two is what I'm trying to get to.
There has to be a line drawn in the sand. If you've already been paying, and that's one of the transition, that's one of the bad things about the transition. There's not a good way to transition over. There's some people that are in their 19th year of paying it off, and there's some people that's in their first or second year of paying it off. We're going to basically draw a line in the sand on July 1st of 2017 and do away with that $3.76 per month fee and go straight over to the 53 cent per month fee. So there's not a good way to draw a line in the sand and transition over. That's what you're asking.
I think it is what I'm asking. How did y'all get to this recommendation versus the status quo where we were?
Several things. You know, one, we're trying to get one system that's the same across the board. trying to get and treating everybody in our, all of our customers the exact same. That's part of what it is. The other is you go back to the original ordinance and you read it, and it says, or ordinance resolution, it talks about the buy-in. And when you start looking at the numbers and the amount of dollars that have been created over the years, and I've got the numbers I can go through if you'd like, buy-in is complete and probably has been complete for quite a few years.
Does that mean that the new, if a person builds tomorrow, they don't have to pay the $525?
Okay, the box on the bottom right is what we're going to do to cover that. Somebody builds tomorrow, they have to pay capacity fee when they come in and get a permit. So we also know that this doesn't take effect to July 1st. Anybody that comes in tomorrow and requests a permit, we're going to try to talk them into waiting and holding off on their permit to July 1st if they can. If they can't and they absolutely have to have the permit today, we've worked up a schedule here as far as if you get a permit in March, we're going to give you a 20% discount on the fee, 40% in April, 60% in May, and 80% in June. We still have to follow by the existing resolution that's in effect, and this is how we've come up to try to encourage you to wait until July 1st to get the permit. Now, in residential, it's a lot easier. If any residential comes in, we can hold the permit. If a commercial comes in, this only really applies to commercial. But if a residential, somebody coming in building a house tomorrow, applies for a permit, we'll hold their permit till July 1st. We just can't do that with commercial.
I got a question.
Yes, sir.
Joe, by holding that permit, is that not going to allow that plumber to get a plumbing permit? Because I believe that you have to get sewer permit when you get the plumbing permit. Is that correct?
And not really, because like right now when we do our capacity fee and a lot of our fees, we do a lot of pre-assessment agreements for residential anyway, where we actually hold the permit in our office and wait to bill them. So that's how we're gonna hold it. We'll still issue the permit so they can still get the plumbing inspection and OMPC can still come out and inspect. We hold it internally. So we'll still issue the permit, but we'll hold it internally in our office.
Thank you.
It'll still be processed. We can't do that with commercial, so we came up with this sliding scale.
Before we leave, any other questions down this way?
Just one other thing, just is there a loss of revenue by doing it this way?
No, sir. This is completely revenue neutral.
Neutral? Okay.
What we're doing is we're taking the money we would have generated over the next 20 years, divided that out into residential, or every one of our users. That's how we got 53 cents.
Commissioner Conder.
Entirely revenue neutral for us.
Thank you, Judge. So basically, if somebody had a year ago paid the $525 up front, sorry about your luck.
Yes, sir.
If you come in 6 months from now, here we go, right?
Yeah, 6 months from now, you'll be on the new
system.
There
we go. And have you gotten in touch or have you got any feedback from developers, residential developers, whomever they are, as far as does that help them be able to attract more individuals to be able to build wherever they're going to be building, or are they just all happy and giddy about this, or what are they saying?
When you start looking at the capacity fee for a residential developer who pays them all up front, okay, let me answer your question first. No, we received zero feedback. Not a single one has called me or anybody on the staff.
It's a little shocking.
But if you look at this, when the developers have to pay this up front,
correct,
you know, the 525 times 100 homes and they have to pay it up front, this goes away. Start looking at some of the recent fees. There's a restaurant being built now on 54 that their capacity fee is going to be $10,000.
So if they delayed their construction by 6 months, they wouldn't have to pay that?
They would delay it until July 1st. They'd have zero capacity fee.
Thank you, Joe. Who's
all that business too?
Yes, sir. Joe, you've talked quite a bit about growth in the community. How many new accounts have we had in the last 2 or 3 years? Or how do you measure growth, I guess, is a better way to put it?
How many new accounts the last 2 or 3 years? Right now, we're gaining about 1.5% per year customers. Right now, we're just shy of 30,000. 1.5% of 30,000 is going to be about, what, 450, if I'm doing math in my head right? Don't quote me on that. I'm doing math in my head way quick.
I can attest to that.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions before we move on? Go ahead, Joe.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. What we're saying is going to be unchanged. All the other fees are going to be unchanged. System development, assessment, all of our quality surcharges, the interest rates on development fees, the borrowing limits, none of that are we proposing to change. Okay, now, Blake showed you what's going to happen if we have a do-nothing alternate. So now I'm going to show you, based on this model, what will happen with these changes. And again, the black line on there is the working capital balance. The first two you add together, which is operating and replacement, you can see for the first 3 years to 4 years, this is looking really good. Years 4 and 5 is hard to predict what's going to happen. Again, is why we want to come to you every 2 years and give you an update. You know, we're going to be looking in 2 years and say, are we being too conservative on our assumptions? What's going on? So we feel that this model does a real good job for the first 3 years and into the fourth. Fifth year, maybe a little questionable, but let's see what's going on first. I don't want to start raising rates in year 5 until we know better what's going on. The environmental improvement fee you see is right at the recommended working capital balance. Again, Blake defined what our working capital balance is for each fund. Year 5 in the environmental looks like it's spiking. But that's because in year 6 and 7, we got a couple really large projects coming up, and that's putting some money in the kitty for that. But again, we'll be able to adjust that if need be. The rest of the funds, again, are self-sufficient. You know, the capacity, you see capacity looks the exact same here on this alternate as it did with the do-nothing, because it is a revenue-neutral system. And it has our reserve fund at the $6 million. This is kind of a busy spreadsheet. We're on slide 15 for if you're looking on the paper. This basically shows everything that is being proposed today. Customer service charge will go from existing of $12.95 up on 5 years from now, it'll be up to $18.45. You can see the wastewater user charge is remaining constant at $4.39, even though it could have gone up to the $4.60. Environmental improvement fee is increasing from the existing of $3.95 to $9.95. Again, keep in mind what we had talked about several years ago was at $6.95. The surcharge for environmental improvement fee is going up 7 cents per year. Capacity base fee is staying constant. We're not recommending any changes. In summary, if you go to slide 18, the table at the top is the exact same table that's on slide 17. If you look at the table on the bottom left, what we're doing is going to show you what the average customer is going to be seeing. Right now, the current average, yes, sir.
Yeah, that's it. It's 16.
Okay, 16. I never said my eyesight was any good. Sorry about that. Okay, so the bottom left is you're going to see the average customer is going to go from $34.02 up to $43.56. Okay, but let me kind of put that in perspective here. Excuse me. The bottom right table is the one that I'd like for you to look at. Okay, if you take our rate structure and say, okay, the environmental improvement fee, that is basically a standalone critter. There's nothing that you can do about that because that is being mandated by the EPA and the Division of Water. So if you pull the environmental improvement fee out of our increases and say, it's not much you can do about that, capacity fee is actually revenue neutral. We're not getting anything additional out of this. Revenue neutral, pull the capacity fee out of our rates. In the bottom right, you see in yellow the 1.9%. Okay, so if you pull out the environmental improvement fee and you pull out the capacity fee, the additional revenue coming into RWRA averages out to a 1.9% per year increase. Keep in mind what we're doing with this fee. This is what we're paying our utility bills with. This is what we're paying our health insurance, our salaries, our chemicals, We're paying everything with this. The last 10 years, the CPI has been going up an average of 1.9%. The last couple days, we got published the CPI for 2016, and it was 2.1. So you're seeing that what we're trying to do now is we're not even keeping up with cost of living with CPI at 2.1%. We're asking for a 1.9% rate increase. So what we're presenting to you today, we feel does a really good job of taking care of our long-term control plan, which is not an option. Does a good job of turning us into a more homogeneous structure where we're treating everybody in our system the same. And we're right at the cost of living with our 1.9% increase, the CPI being at 2.1 last year. So this is a bare bones basic budget that we're bringing to you. Restructuring a little bit, but still a bare bones basic structure. So at that point, I'd like to open it up for any questions.
Commissioners, Commissioner Smith-Wright, I think you have a question that's unanswered. You want to ask him again? How do we compare with other systems?
Okay. Right now, this is the current structure. If you see that right there in blue, RWRA currently is at $34.02 on the average. We're right in the middle. These are the same 12 or 13 that we've been using for the last couple rate review board meetings. You see right now we're right in the middle of that. If you look below us, the ones with asterisks are the ones that are also CSO communities. There's only two CSO communities that are below us. That's Henderson and Paducah. We know that both of them are going through some pretty significant rate structures, some rate increases. And I can tell you Lexington's below us, but I will tell you this right now, Lexington has already published that in the next 10 years, their rates are going to double. You look at ours in the next 5 years, we're talking, I believe the number was about 5%. You know, so you compare Lexington in the next 10 years is going to double. We're talking 5%. Evansville, which is up there, their published rate increases are significant. So that number that you see in Evansville is going to go way up. If I can tell you about Evansville, I can tell you about Lexington. I know all the others are also going to be going up significantly. A year from now, it's our prediction that we're going to be dropping down on that list.
How does St. Louis get in that mix? Because, I mean, it's so much larger than Owensboro. And I mean, and it's just $10 more.
There's a couple things you got to be real careful about. One, answer your question, how they get in the mix. I don't know. These are the same 12 or 14 that's been used in the last several rate review board meetings. So to be consistent, we use the same one today. You got to be real careful because so many of these have got a lot of add-on fees. You know, our base rate of $34, that, you know, we've got a couple of other add-on fees. Everybody else up there has got add-on fees. This is a chart you got to be real careful. It's not like saying what does a gallon of gas cost in Owensboro versus a gallon of gas cost in St. Louis. All these add-on fees and everything that everybody has, you got to be real careful on comparing these base rates because they don't include all the add-ons.
Then just a suggestion, I wouldn't do that. If you know that they have all these add-on fees, that's not fair to put them on the board.
Well, yes, ma'am. And that's why this wasn't in my main presentation.
Joe, one of the reasons they may be up there is we're looking at combined sewer and stormwater systems. That would be just one more of those that we know that's existing. Uh-huh. So, commissioners? Yes, sir. Mayor.
Go ahead, Mayor, please.
Is it appropriate for Ed Ray to jump in here? He knows more about the TIF and all the stuff that's going on there. Good, is it okay with you if he asks a question about what possibly might be going on that we part-timers don't know?
Mr. Ray.
Thank you, Judge. Appreciate that. Joe, one of the questions that has been kind of filtering out there is, in the revenues that you're projecting going forward, is any of the TIF revenue that we have slated to pay back debt service on the $6 to $7 million in projects. Is the TIF revenue in your figures, or is that something that you're going to come back in 2 years and say it did come to fruition and now we're able to adjust these rates down?
It did not, for one reason. The main reason we did not include it in there, well, two reasons. One, we don't know what the exact dollar amount is, so we have no idea what to put in there. Second reason, we don't know what the schedule is. This is a 5-year rate study. We're proposing to come back every 2 years. You know, when will we start realizing the TIF money coming into RWRA? So our thought, and we had a lot of discussions about, do we include the TIF money? We chose not to, but in lieu of that, come back to you all in 2 years, because the likelihood of us getting any TIF money of substantial amount within 2 years, I don't know what that is. We've never been provided a true schedule of, you will get this amount in this year and you will get this amount in this year. So because of that, we chose not to put it in there, but instead, if it starts coming in, then we can come back in 2 years and adjust it. So, and that's the main reason.
With a model, it's pretty easy to change the figures. That's why you create a model.
Why created the model.
Ed? But yes. Anyone else? Yes, sir. Commissioner.
One quick question. So go back to this list for just a second. How many of these cities have their EPA agreement done or needed to have one? I know some cities didn't, because if you don't have a river,
everybody with
Lexington
did.
Yeah, Dean, if you're going to talk.
An asterisk is required to have it.
Everybody that's got an asterisk.
As far as how many have it yet?
Yeah, how many have
it? Our expert.
Yeah. Okay.
Identify yourself so we'll all know who you are.
Let us know where you live.
Too. Yeah, that's exactly right.
Dean Bankey, live in Henderson.
May the rates be with you.
All right. We can still get a little occupational license for you.
Okay.
Everybody's on a different schedule, and everybody that's got a schedule, like St. Louis is in there, they have a $4.7 billion consent judgment or consent decree. And so their dollars, they're doing this whole program over 25, 30 years, and it's hitting everybody a different time. Paducah and Henderson. Henderson was a little unique because I think a small portion of their town was combined sewer, so it wasn't as much task, and they did a separation thing. And they got ahead of it, you know, in the years ago. So I'm not sure what other their fees are, but Paducah's one that's a little behind our schedule. They got approved, but the reality of that hasn't happened yet, of the rates going up to address it. My understanding is their agreement is substantially higher number than ours, you know, dollar spent, and it's a smaller community, so the rates got to go up.
But just to conclude.
In Evansville stuff. I mean, Evansville is.
The good news for us is that impact has now been assessed into this 5-year proposal, and we're in good shape in that regard. We can be confident we're not going to be bumped up again or have to address this issue again in the near future.
I think the good news.
10 years anyway.
Yeah, the good news, Dean, is that the EPA, just as a gauge, says that if you don't come to an agreement with us, you might be told that you will have to charge 2% of the mean income or median income in the community, which is about $53,000 in Owensboro. So we would be paying $1,000 or better a year, which is about $88 a year, as opposed to your projected $43 in 5 years. So kudos to RWRA, because they got ahead of the game and have been doing that since the mayor was mayor the first time. Okay. Thanks, Dean. Did that answer your question?
Yes, it did. Thank you. Thanks, Dean.
Any other questions? Yes, sir. Commissioner Wathen.
My question, I want to just talk a little bit about, I'm going to have to explain myself to ask this question. You were talking about the capacity fee and how you're redoing that and sort of spreading that across the system, so to speak, which I think is a good idea. Part of the problem I have, and I guess it's my biggest pet peeve about this system that we that RWA uses and we're a part of because we have to help, is the assessment fee that some of these people have to pay, and also the system development fee, which I myself would like to see the same logic applied to these fees as we hear from the capacity fee. And part of the reason for that is because, for example, when you, I know the environmental fee has been used oftentimes to say go into a, it goes into a specific neighborhood and solves a drainage problem, a flash flood problem, but the whole system is paying for that through the via my understanding is environmental fee. So I guess my biggest problem is the way we do the assessment and the way we do those fees for the new, when we go into a neighborhood with a whole new system. So I myself, I know it's too late to do it this time, but I'd like to see that same logic applied to those two fees. I think at least to the system development fee, I think that's what, $2,100 or something like that. I think it's too severe of a fee for these people.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to jump from that to my next point, is I think when we do, when we go into a new neighborhood, oftentimes we'll use the survey. We say, well, we're going to use the survey. And I'm running into a lot of situations where the survey is what I would call outdated, you know, 5, 6, 7 years old. And we've got, in some cases, we've got a whole new set of residents in that neighborhood. And so when you say you've done I did a survey 10 years ago, I'm sure you would find a whole different set of people. And also, and this is an even bigger part of that survey, I think oftentimes when they do the survey, it's done by a neighbor and they don't really know what the cost is. And they come flying through the neighborhood and they say, man, we can get us some sewers. And they say, what's it gonna cost? I don't know, $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, I don't know. So there's no real control of the cost estimate. I believe it ought to be an absolute cost estimate. In other words, if we build this sewer, it's going to cost you $5,000. Do you want a sewer? Because I think if I was a resident, I would have a different answer if you said, I don't, you know, probably 4,000, maybe 5 at the most, and then it came in at 10. So I would make a different decision on that little box on that survey if you told me 10,000 than I would 5,000. And then, so, and I guess the last part of that, I think if the original estimate needs to be controlled with the survey, and there needs to be a time limit put on that, maybe 2, 3, 4 years, and then you have to redo the survey, and if you miss by 20% on the dollar cost, you need to do a new survey, because I think it changes the game, completely changes the game. Okay. And we've got that particular situation, and you know where it is.
Yes, sir.
Where people where thought it was going to be around 3 or 4, maybe 5,000, and they're talking about 10,000 or maybe more.
Commissioner, I guess what I hear you say is that those fees aren't changing, and we're talking about the fee structure, but that you would like him to look at those fees in the next, over the next 2 years, right? And possibly the other things that you talk about aren't necessarily rates that are under the purview of this board. It's more policy.
Well, but it's in the
I understand, but what I'm saying is
what we're voting on today's assessments and how
those are the fees, and they don't change today. But I hear what you're saying is that you would like him to look at the way they determine those in the future going forward and bring back some kind of recommendation. Would that be a fair?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
I will say this on the survey, and you're 100% correct. The survey we have on our website now is entirely different. The survey that's on our website that they see has every single fee on it. So somebody comes in today and picks up a survey, or they download it today, it has every fee, and they know that it's going to be closer to the 10,000. So we're doing a better job of informing them. As far as the other two, I think there's a couple legal issues with KRS 76 that prevents that from happening, what you're saying. But what we'll do at the next rate review board meeting, we will have that as part of our presentation.
Okay, good.
I have to get some attorneys in on that and help me interpret 76, because our interpretation of 76, you cannot do that with assessment. But let me get the attorneys involved, and I'll have a presentation at the next meeting for you.
I don't want to rush anybody, but we've got another meeting at 4 o'clock, but we'll stay here and take as much time as anybody wants. So
I want one more thing.
Go ahead.
Why do you have so many different fees? For example, the customer service charge, the wastewater user charge, and the environmental improvement fee are all fixed. They don't change. So why don't you just combine those things instead of having such a confusing fee system?
Okay. The customer service charge is a fixed fee. Wastewater user charge is based on volume. They have to be two separate. Environmental, we have that separated so that everybody out there knows exactly what the long-term control plan is costing us. If we lumped environmental in with customer service and just said customer service / environmental, you start losing track of what are we spending on our day-to-day operations and what are we spending on the long-term control plan. By having two separate fees, it's transparent. Everybody knows exactly what you're getting.
Actual answer is we can lay the $395 environmental fee on the feds. Any other? Yes, sir.
Joe, since we're talking about rates, we have a little bit of this concern about the plans on the west side. I understand that you're planning to build a pump station some 1,500 feet from Fisher Park. And as you well know, since you're a former city employee, that's a major driver of outside dollars. And I would say, more often than not, those things have a little odor to them. And so I'm just wondering, it's close to Greenbelt, and the one down at McConnell Plaza has got a little bit of a stench to it every now and then. And so I'm concerned it's going to hurt our economic engine for the west side if you put that rascal right there. So I'm just getting that out there, if you understand what I'm saying.
Yes, sir. I know it's hard to see behind you. I went in and pulled up a little map of what you're talking about there. We're going to do something different on this pump station that we haven't done anywhere else on any pump station that we have. Down here at, like you said, beside McConnell Plaza, about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when RWRA rebuilt that, we put in a new ozone odor treatment system on that one. I know, like you said, sometimes it has a little stench, but compare the stench it has today to what it did before the ozone treatment. And I know that it's not considered entirely fixed, but you compare the two, you see the improvements that have been made. And now let's switch gears and go out to Horse Fork. That's the one on the bypass, the inside the bypass by the Greenbelt in between 431 and 231. And now that one has some of the oldest sewage anywhere coming through it. That pump station, several months ago, we added a filter media to it. It's called, on that one, it's called EcoSorb. Basically, it's just a media that's been put onto it. I don't know if you've been by it since we've done that.
Every day.
That odor has been almost completely eliminated. Okay, so what we're doing on this one, we already have in the plans, we're putting both on it. We recognize that, one, it's against the Greenbelt. Two, it's across from some businesses. Three, it's right up against the park. Our original conversations we've had with the city, we knew that was a concern. We're putting both on there. So we're getting a redundant system. And again, go by the one that's out there by the Greenbelt, out on the bypass. Since we've had that on there, the odor has been almost completely eliminated. We're putting both on it. So a redundant system between the two. We feel real strong about the fact that this is going to take care of the odor.
So is that going to affect the rates, putting all that extra stuff?
That's been built into this from the very beginning.
Yep.
Both of those systems have been in the plans from day one. And before we even went to KIA, before we did the planning, Those were in, both systems were in the design of that pump station.
Let me just say this. Anyone who's here for the airport board presentation, they will be immediately following. JT, you came early, but you're really late for this meeting, so we don't care. Commissioner.
Just a quick comment. Out on Frederica Street, by, I don't know if it's between E.M. Ford and Jimmy John's.
Okay.
There's a stench there also. And, you know, when people are trying to eat, that's, I mean, so are you doing anything about that? I'm just.
Let's look at that with Commissioner.
Commissioner, let me just say this, and anyone else, if you have questions regarding the rates.
Okay.
Okay, if not, I would encourage you to get together with Dean and Joe, and they will be happy to do that. Yes, Commissioner.
Back to her.
Thank you, Judge.
You're welcome.
Just as a matter of procedure, please. When we were talking about transparency earlier, yeah. Commissioner Wathen was talking about wanting to lump everything together and trying to make just one fee. Myself, I'm on the opposite side of that because I see noted here a rate that we are asked to approve that has three, not only three, but every one of the rates that RWRA has out there, and it's a yes or no vote. Either vote yes or no. You may like two, may not like the other one. So I would ask procedurally, I understand that you cannot, don't want to go through the process of changing this the way I'm asking for it to be done. But in the future, please, if you could separate them out individually so they can be voted up and or down or questioned in that manner, if possible. I understand the procedures, but I respectfully ask for that, please.
Joe, you understand that question?
Yes,
okay. So any other?
You'd end up with six or seven resolutions, which is no problem to us. If
okay.
It's no problem, six or seven votes.
The only problem will be that you're basing your total income on all of those rates being passed. So any other question? All right. The agenda item for consideration by the Rate Review Board is to approve the resolution of the schedule for wastewater rates, rentals, charges, and policies. RWRA's board has recommended changes to RWRA's schedule for wastewater rates, rentals, charges, and policies. These recommendations include an increase to the monthly environmental fee by $1.20 annually and the environmental volume charge for high-volume users by 7 cents per 1,000 gallons annually for the next 5 years. The board is also recommending not to take the increase that was approved by the last rate review board for the wastewater user charge, but to keep this rate constant at $4.39 per 1,000 gallons for the next 5 years. The RWRA board is recommending changing the monthly customer service charge fee to reflect the meter size and to increase the base monthly rate for the customer service charge by $1.10 annually for the next 5 years. The RWRA rate, our board is recommending to restructure the capacity fee to be charged to all customers, and similar to the customer service charge will vary with meter size. The proposed base rate for the capacity fee is 53 cents per month. This rate will remain constant for the next 5 years. All other fees will remain constant, as will the interest rates and borrowing limits. The RWRA board recommends RWRA reappear before the Rate Review Board every 2 years for an update. The action recommended is that the Rate Review Board approve the resolution authorizing RWRA to implement the schedule for wastewater rates, rentals, charges, and policies as proposed, and I would entertain a motion to that effect. I have a motion to approve.
Second.
I have a second. Is there any additional comment or discussion? Yes, Mayor.
Since I'm new, you know, there's a lot of information to try to digest in an hour and a half or whatever it is. And I know nobody likes to meet worse than I like to meet, but, you know, it's pretty critical for a lot of people and somewhat uncomfortable saying, yeah, this is the best thing I've ever heard of, because I'm not clear on everything that we're doing as opposed to what we did before. So that's probably my fault. So my suggestion is that maybe we have a little powwow or something to get us up to speed before we have to make a vote that affects so many people in our community.
Mayor, we have a motion and a second on the floor. So So I don't know how we would proceed there.
No, not.
Are you saying?
That was just discussion in general.
Okay, later. You want to go ahead with? Okay,
yeah, we'll go ahead with the vote, but I'm just saying as part of discussion.
Yes.
You know, there needs to be a little bit more background information for someone as simple as me, so that I'll be better prepared when I come.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood that.
No problem.
Make sure.
And I agree, and I think RWRA would agree with that as well. Any other comment? Do you want to do a roll call for the vote? Yes.
Judge Mattingly?
Aye.
Commissioner Caslin?
Aye.
Commissioner Wathen?
Aye.
Commissioner Koger?
Aye.
Mayor Watson?
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Bob Glenn?
Aye.
Commissioner Smith Wright?
Aye.
Commissioner Velotta?
Aye.
Commissioner Conder?
Aye. The motion carries unanimously. I want to thank everyone. Do we have anything else to do? I think that's it. Yes. I want to thank everyone for being here. I know it's a long time. Mayor, you're exactly right. It's a whole lot of information to digest in about an hour's time. Commissioner Glenn, I'm going to give you one second.
I just wanted to say, though, that thank you and your staff for the presentation you did and all the work I'm sure that went into this.
And I think the rate review board would echo those comments, so thank you. Without exception, if there's no other business to be brought before the rate review board, we're adjourned.
Thank you, sir.